Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin. Assalatu wassalamu ala asrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi rasulillahi ajmain. Amma ba'du, fa ibadallah, ittaqullaha haqqa tuqatih wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. Shadaqallahul azim. Mahasiswa saya sekalian yang di Universitas Islam Negeri Imam Bonjol Padang, kita bertemu lagi di video kali ini, yaitu mata kuliah pengembangan kreativitas, oh bukan, mata kuliah Academic and Professional Speaking, yaitu untuk saya lihat jadwal saya untuk mahasiswa sesi TBIA ya. Nah, I'm going to speak with you by using English and Bahasa Indonesia interchangeably, ganti-gantian. Nah, jadi, please listen to me carefully because it's going to be a bit longer explanation about the concept that I want to explain to you. Okay. So here is my PowerPoint. So this is the topic about that I'm going to talk to you at this present moment. Karena pada waktu itu hari Rabu Kamis 29 dan 30 September ada hujan-hujan badai, Kota Padang dilanda banjir, ada musibah juga seperti itu. Jadi inisiatif saya aja, kebijakan saya saja untuk kita untuk melakukan perkuliahan secara asinkronus. Biasanya kita menggunakan Zoom. Jadi ada di atas dari peraturan ada kebijakan. Dan saya harap kebijakan yang saya ambil ini tidak terlalu banyak pengaruhnya buat Anda semua. Ya, jadi Anda bisa menyaksikan video ini kapan saja kalian mau, selama satu minggu itu. Bisa hari Minggu, Senin, Selasa, dan bisa dengan cara santai. Ya, oke. Okay. Tapi jangan lupa ketik nama dan NIM-nya untuk bukti memang bahwa kalian telah mendengar dan menyimak video ini. Part 1, how to be a good speaker on academic presentation. Jadi konteks yang akan saya jelaskan ini yaitu bagaimana menjadi pembicara yang bagus untuk presentasi akademik. Jadi yang itu yang harus digarisbawahi yang ini ya. Jadi kata academic presentation. Dan ini ada kata good. Ini artinya bahwa kita diminta atau dituntut untuk menjadi pembicara yang bagus di dalam konteks academic presentation. Sekarang kita lihat terlebih dahulu apa yang menjadi academic presentation. What is that? Di sebuah situs yang saya ambil di Microsoft Bing, it says from best academic presentation topics for students in 2021. Jadi cukup terbaru. Jadi saya ambil definisinya adalah di situs ini. So, in other words, I quoted this information for all of you. Let me read this one. An academic presentation is an effective task that develops a student's communication skills. They later use these skills in their professional and personal lives in the future after studies. Shy students might struggle with talking in front of an audience, but learning about the true power of speech will help them overcome their fears. Jadi konsep dari academic presentation ini ternyata adalah keterampilan berkomunikasi yang sangat bermanfaat bagi mahasiswa. Tidak hanya untuk kehidupan profesional mereka, tapi juga untuk kehidupan pribadi mereka setelah mereka wisuda nanti dan masuk ke dunia kerja. Kenapa? Karena berkomunikasi di konteks presentasi atau seminar berbeda dengan berkomunikasi dalam kehidupan sehari-hari atau face to face. Sebagai mahasiswa, kita tentu dituntut untuk bisa menggunakan bahasa dengan baik. Shy students di sini, shy student ini maksudnya mahasiswa yang cenderung pemalu, cukup akan struggle, berjuang dengan keras berbicara di depan umum ya pasti, bagi yang merasa pemalu, takut-takut ngomong, kemudian merasa dihakimi sama orang, ini biasanya akan grogi mereka kalau berbicara di depan umum. Akan berbeda kalau orang-orang yang sudah bisa mengatasi ketakutan mereka. Saya lihat slide berikutnya. Ini saya kutip dari Wiley tentang academic presentation. Wiley ini sebuah situs yang menurut saya cukup bagus ya. The Wiley Network, bisa kontennya untuk instructors and students, journal editors, librarians, professionals, researchers, dan society leaders. Nah, kebetulan, bukan kebetulan sih, yang saya ambil untuk kalian ini adalah dari sesi researcher, peneliti, karena konteksnya kalian adalah mahasiswa senior. Six tips for giving a fabulous academic presentation. Ini ditulis oleh Tanya Golodz-Boza, Associate Professor of Sociology, University of California. Ini ditulis pada tanggal 8 Maret tahun 2018. So, cukup baru ya, baru 3 tahun yang lalu. Tip pertama, nah, jadi apa tip pertama menurut Associate Professor ini di University of California, use PowerPoint judicially. Ketika Anda melakukan academic presentation, tentu Anda akan menggunakan aplikasi PowerPoint, Microsoft PowerPoint. It's apapun bentuknya, biasanya yang PowerPoint memang PowerPoint disebut ya, karena Microsoft yang pertama kali menyebutnya PowerPoint. Images are powerful. Nah, ini harus diingat, gambar-gambar begitu sangat penting dan berpengaruh. Research shows that images help with memory and learning. Use this to your advantage by finding and using images that help you make your point. One trick I have learned is that you can use images that have blank space in them and you can put words in those images. Here is one such example from a presentation I gave about immigration law enforcement. Jadi ini salah satu contoh dari penggunaan immigration law enforcement. Jadi kebetulan situs ini tidak ditampilkannya. Nah, pertama, gunakan PowerPoint itu judicially. Judicially ini dengan secara bijak. Jadi jangan terlalu full, penuh. Nah, seperti di layar saya ini kan banyak kosakata. Karena memang saya gunakan untuk mengajar kepada mahasiswa. Ditambah dengan penjelasan saya ini. Ya, ini poin-poinnya dan yang menjadi powernya adalah kita yang berbicara. Ya, jadi jangan banyak terlalu banyak tulisan di layar atau di display karena nanti kesannya bukan kita yang menjelaskan. Ya, perhatian audiens akan lari kepada layar sementara kita akan diacuhkan. PowerPoint is a great tool so long as users use it effectively. Generally, this means using lots of visuals and relatively few words. Never use less than 24-point font. And please, never put your presentation on the slides and read from the slides. Jadi, ini berbeda ya. Kalau kita presentasi dengan menggunakan Zoom, kita bisa menampakkan kepada audiens bahwa kita membaca slides. Tapi seperti yang saya lakukan sekarang, I don't read my slides. Tadi ya barusan saya baca. Nah sekarang ketika saya berbicara kepada Anda, saya tidak membaca slide. So, I explain it. I give you the description. For the first tip, use PowerPoint judicially. The next one that I'm going to be talking about is tip number two. There is a formula to academic presentations. Use it. Jadi menurut Tanya, ada formula presentasi akademik. Harus kita gunakan katanya ya. So this is what it says. Once you have become an expert at giving fabulous presentations, you can deviate from the formula. However, if you are new to presenting, you might want to follow it. This will vary slightly by field. Jadi cukup berbeda dari satu bidang ke bidang yang lainnya katanya. However, I will give you an example from my field, sociology, to give you an idea as to what the format should look like. Ini dari bidang sosiologi, yang dijelaskan oleh Tanya. The first one is introduction, overview, or hook. Nah, jadi ini pemancing ini. So, you introduce your research or you explain what you're going to be talking about in your presentation. That is the overview, or you give the hook with a question or an interesting anecdote or short story, sesuatu yang bisa kalian gunakan pembuka agar pendengar mendengar kepada Anda, ya. Yang kedua, theoretical framework or research question. Jadi, ketika Anda presentasi nanti, misalnya presentasi monokosa atau presentasi seminar proposal atau presentasi kompre, maka Anda format yang kedua ini adalah jelaskan theoretical framework. Apa kerangka teorinya? Apa yang Anda gunakan di dalam penelitian Anda? Kalau misalnya dia seminar proposal, what will you do, yeah, or with the theory? What theory that you will implement in your research analysis? Atau di sisi lain, kalau misalnya proposal Anda berupa qualitative research design, maka Anda bisa menuliskan research question. Apa pertanyaan penelitian yang akan Anda jawab melalui penelitian tersebut? Nah, aspek yang ini sangat penting untuk Anda pertimbangkan. Yang ketiga, methodology or case selection. Jadi ada metodologinya atau pilihan kasus. Metodologi ini bentuk method-nya apa, and then what is the approach, what about the technique of data collection and technique of data analysis, and how you will interpret the data. Itu semuanya harus dijelaskan di bagian methodology or case selection. And then the next one, we have the background or literature review. Background ini latar dari penelitian kita. Apa yang mendasari Anda mau melakukan penelitian itu? Why did you want to do this research? And then we have literature review. Apa tinjauan kepustakaannya? You can quote the most updated research findings in many international journals. You can also quote theories that are stated in dated textbooks or the core theory book. For example, I have quoted the book of Geoffrey Leach about pragmatics. So later on, I know that the book had been used by many experts in the field. Jadi ada buku lama sekali tahun 1962 misalnya, tapi buku tersebut dikutip oleh banyak pakar, maka bisa Anda kutip as the theoretical foundation. Tapi harus Anda review, ya. Literature review itu Anda review, Anda kaji ulang dia literaturnya, ya. Jadi jangan di jangan disebutkan saja, tapi juga Anda kaji. And then after that, you present the discussion of data or results. Apa datanya yang Anda temukan setelah Anda lakukan penelitian? What did you get? What did you find? Sebutkan, kalau misalnya berupa angka-angka datanya, tampilkan di layar. Kalau presentasi, apa presentasinya? Kalau berupa gambaran statement, Anda sebutkan di layar. Yeah? So, you explain it. And then after that, it is followed by analysis. Nah, analysis ini adalah cara Anda berpikir secara nalar dan secara intuitif. Anda jelaskan, what does it mean with the analysis? What does it mean with the data? Apa maksud dari data yang terkumpul? Misalnya contoh, ditemukan 15,7%, sementara 2,5% mengalami B. 15,7% mengalami A. Apa artinya yang persentase tadi, A dengan B? Berapa selisihnya? What does it mean to you? What does it mean for your research? Itu yang dijelaskan di analysis. Ya. Setelah Anda menjelaskan analisanya dengan sistematis, dan juga Anda sebutkan jawaban dari research question, lalu Anda berikan kesimpulan. You conclude. Jangan lupa. Jadi ini strukturnya ya, ada formulanya. Jadi jangan langsung jumping. My research found out that. Maksudnya step by step. Satu persatu ya. Perlahan-lahan. And then tip number 3, the audience wants to hear about your research. tell them. Jadi para pendengar itu ingin mendengarkan tentang penelitian Anda. Katakan, sampaikan pada mereka. One of the most common mistakes I see in people giving presentations is that they present only information I already know. This usually happens when they spend nearly all of the presentation going over the existing literature and giving background information on their particular case. You need only to discuss the literature with which you are directly engaging and contributing. Your background information should only include what is absolutely necessary. If you are giving a 15-minute presentation, by the sixth minute, you need to be discussing your data or case study. At conferences, people are there to learn about your new and exciting research, not to hear a summary of old work. Okay. Jadi, intinya di sini, untuk tip ketiga, katanya salah satu kesalahan orang dalam memberikan academic presentation adalah mengulang-ulang hal-hal yang sudah lama disampaikan. Jadi kalau misalnya ada waktu 15 menit untuk presentasi, maka Anda harus ingat di menit ke-6 Anda sudah harus masuk ke bagian penyajian data dan analisa. Jadi jangan berlama-lama di kajian teori, karena orang tidak terlalu butuh informasi tentang teori. Sampaikan hanya pentingnya saja. Jadi 15 menit dibagi 3, 5 menit pertama, 5 menit kedua, 5 menit terakhir. Ya. Nah, jadi you manage your time. Karena that's very important. Hal-hal yang sangat penting itu adalah background, kemudian theory, methodology, data, finding, and result, conclusion. So you cut them all. Masukkan bagian-bagiannya. Misalnya 2 menit untuk background, 2 menit untuk research question, 1 menit untuk research question, kemudian teori mungkin 2 atau 3 menit, itu sudah berapa menit itu? Sudah 5. Nah, masuk dia langsung ke bagian methodology. Itu tip yang ketiga. According to Tanya, Golosh, and Bowser. The next one, tip number 4, remember that you need to do practice, practice, and practice. You should always practice your presentation in full before you deliver it. You might feel silly delivering your presentation to your cat or your toddler. Toddler means a baby who can walk. But you need to do it and do it again. You need to practice to ensure that your presentation fits within the time parameters. Practicing also makes it flow better. You can't practice too many times. Jadi praktek ini maksudnya adalah Anda coba gunakan PowerPoint yang sudah Anda buat itu, Anda praktekkan berbicara di depan kaca atau di depan teman, minta teman komentari, how did you present the presentation? Was it interesting? Was it boring? Was it making people sleepy? Or was it something new that people want to hear? Oh, I see, what is that? What does it mean? Okay, so try to engage with your audience. Jadi, coba berinteraksi dengan pembaca. Saya sekarang seperti ini. Kalau kalian menyimak dari awal, berarti saya sudah berinteraksi dengan Anda, ya. Itu yang harus dipahami. Yang kelima, keep to your time limit. Ingat, waktu, ya. Time. Time is the key. If you are given for 10 or 15 minutes, jangan mentang-mentang kita misalnya pejabat negara, atau kita rektor, atau kita kepala daerah, atau kita gubernur, wali kota, jangan mengambil waktu lebih dari yang disediakan. Kalau misalnya waktu sudah habis, sudah potong saja. Demikian yang saya sampaikan. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Jadi jangan bertele-tele seperti ini. Oh, I'm sorry if I say something wrong. If this is wrong, it was from me. Everything good is from God. Nggak perlu kita sebutkan. Kadang orang tidak ada mencari kesalahan kita. Justru kita yang mengingatkan orang mendengarkan kita untuk melihat kesalahan kita. So you just focus on. Keep to your time limit. If you have 10 minutes to present, prepare 10 minutes of material. Jadi kalau diberi waktu 10 menit, ya udah prepare materi yang bisa digunakan untuk 10 menit. Jangan lebih dari 10 menit. No more. Even if you only have 7 minutes, you need to finish within the allotted time. kalaupun misalnya tinggal waktu 1 menit misalnya, kita terlambat datang, sudah termakan waktu kita presentasi selama 5 menit, tinggal 5 menit, ya sudah cut semuanya, 5 minutes, enough, sharp. Karena kenapa? Karena itu akan mengganggu yang akan presentasi berikut-berikutnya, ya. So we need to be considerate about the time. You write your presentation out, a general rule of thumb is 2 minutes per typed double space page. For a 15-minute talk, you should have no more than 7 double space pages of material. Nah, itu ketentuannya. Jadi kalau misalnya waktu yang diberi 10 menit, udah 10 menit. Do not take it more than that. Okay. The next one, I'm going to show you tip number 6. Don't read your presentation. Kalau saya lakukan sekarang ini memang saya membaca. Tapi ketika nanti Anda presentasi di hall, di hotel, di conferences misalnya, atau Anda presentasi untuk Anda menjadi CEO, atau Anda menjadi manager, jangan baca PowerPoint. Interaksi dengan audiens. Ya. Makanya ada PowerPoint. Keep talking, explaining. Don't just reading the slide. Jangan hanya baca slide. Kalau kalian hanya baca slide, you're not going to improve. You need to interact with your audience, right? Yes, I know that in some fields, reading is the norm, but can you honestly say that you find yourself engaged when listening to someone read their conference presentation? If you absolutely must read, I suggest you read in such a way that no one in the audience can tell you are reading. I've seen people do this successfully, and you can do it too if you write in a conversational tone. Conversational tone, ini maksudnya dari style kita, seolah-olah kita bercakap-cakap dengan audience, ya. Practice several times and read your paper with emoticon, with emotion, conviction, and variation in tone. Seperti saya lakukan ini, kita kan membaca ini. Tapi nadanya saya, ada yang saya naikkan, ada yang saya streskan, ada yang saya datarkan. So, as if I am talking to you. Meskipun saya membaca. Yeah. So, that is tip number 6. It's going to be interesting point of view if you would ask me. Jadi, poin-poin yang sebelumnya itu, yang dari Tanya Golos-Boza, Associate Professor of Sociology di University of California, menjelaskan bahwa ada 6 tip ketika kita ingin memberikan fabulous academic presentation. I do not own the credit for these tips, but I have the credit for my explanation to you all. Okay, so consider that I take this material from Wiley like quotation, and I don't steal the ideas from the source, right? That's the consideration for this video for my students and for general viewers who might be interested about what I'm explaining at this point. Now we move on. I take the source from the University of Edinburgh. This is in the UK. Ada dari Inggris. So the content is about this one. Okay, it says the academic presentation, Institute for Academic Development, academic presentation. Ya, jadi kita lihat sumber yang berbeda. Presenting your work allows you to demonstrate your knowledge and familiarity of your subject. Presentations can vary from being formal, like a mini lecture, to more informal, such as summarizing a paper in a tutorial. You may have a specialist audience made up of 4 of your peers, lecturers, or research practitioners, or a wider audience at a conference or event. Sometimes you will be asked questions. Academic presentations are typically oral, such as a talk with slides or a poster presentation, and they may be assessed. Presentations may be individual or collaborative, group work. Itu konsep dari the University of Edinburgh tentang presentasi secara akademik. Jadi ada audiens yang menyimak, yang mungkin pakar di bidang tertentu. Kemudian setelah kita menyajikan materinya, kita akan diberikan pertanyaan, dan pada umumnya academic presentation sifatnya oral, ya, dengan pembicaraan. Kemudian presentasinya bisa individu excuse me, bisa kerja kolaboratif. What about the basics? Apa hal-hal paling basic yang harus mahasiswa perhatikan dalam hal ini adalah the first one, a good presentation will communicate your main points to an audience clearly, concisely, and logically. Your audience doesn't know what it is you are trying to say, what you are trying to say, so you need to guide them through your argument. There are a few key points that you should consider with any sort of presenting. The first one, what is the format? Is it a poster, a talk with visual material, or a video? Number two, what is the purpose? For example, to summarize a debate, report the results of an experiment, present field work, justify your research approach. Nah, jadi, apa tujuannya Anda memberikan presentasi? Yang pertama tadi, apa formatnya? Formatnya apakah dia dalam bentuk poster atau sebuah pembicaraan dengan menggunakan materi visual atau video? Who is your audience? Siapa pendengar Anda ketika Anda nanti akan melakukan presentasi secara akademik? Number four, what content needs to be included? Do you need to cover everything, this one topic, or a particular aspect? How much detail is expected? Isinya tentang apa yang harus Anda masukkan? Dan apakah isinya itu mencakup semua hal, semuanya, atau hanya satu topik atau aspek tertentu saja? Dan seberapa lengkap yang diharapkan dari presentasi ini, kan? Presentasi yang akan Anda berikan secara akademik. Last question, or the basic is, how should it be organized? This is often the trickiest part of designing a presentation and can take a few attempts. Bagian keempat ini bagaimana sih dalam mengaturnya begitu? Nah, kalau misalnya dalam menyusun presentasi harus A, B, C, D, E, maka harus semuanya teratur dari awal sampai akhir. So, can take a few attempts. Planning a presentation. Bagaimana cara kita menyusun sebuah presentasi? According to the University of Edinburgh, Institute for Academic Development, pengembangan secara akademik, I think this is a valid source for you, my students. Again, I'm taking this material not for me to sell it to people, but to equip me in explaining this material to my students. So I do not steal. So consider that I quote the source from the University of Edinburgh. Planning a presentation, bagaimana cara kita merancang atau merencanakan sebuah presentasi? Different people take different approaches to presentations. Some may start by doing some reading and research. Others prefer to draft and outline structures. To make an effective start, check your course materials for the format you need to use, example handbooks, and learn pages for style and guidelines. Hold on, wait for a while. So I'm back. To make an effective start, check your course material for the format you need to use, for example, handbooks, and learn pages for style guidelines. If it is an oral presentation, how long do you have? If it will be assessed, have a look at the marking criteria so you know how you will be marked. If you do not use the required formatting, you may be penalized. Do you need to allow time for questions? Jadi harus diatur apakah handoutnya seperti apa, kemudian apakah dia oral presentation, and then apakah dia berapa lama waktu Anda akan diberikan, serta apa saja kriteria-kriteria yang perlu dipertimbangkan. Okay? Nah, jadi menurut the University of Edinburgh, one way to think about the content and draft a rough structure of your presentation is to divide it into a beginning, middle, and end. The beginning, permulaan ya. How are you going to set the scene for your audience and set out what they can expect to get from your presentation. This section should highlight the key topics and give any necessary background. How much background depends on your attitude in on your audience. For example, your peers might need less of an introduction to a topic than other audiences. Jadi beginning ini pertimbangannya adalah kita harus melihat audiens kita ini seperti apa. Excuse me. Jadi kita memberikan necessary background, gitu. Latar yang penting untuk mereka. Kalau tidak, nanti it's going to be a boring for them. So give the background, but don't too much. But don't to be too little. Somewhere in the middle, that will be fine. Yang berikutnya adalah the middle. How are you going to tell the story of your work? This section should guide your audience through your argument, leading them to your key points. Remember to include any necessary evidence and support. You might also want to include or refer to relevant methods and materials. Ini penting, bagian middle dari presentasi kita. Makanya seperti saya bilang tadi, kalau diberi waktu 15 menit, bagi 3, 5 menit, 5 menit, dan 5 menit terakhir. Jadi seperti ini, depend on your time. Kalau diberi waktu 7 menit misalnya, dibagi 2, 2, 3. Okay, atau 2, 3, 2. Jadi yang middle ini cukup panjang dibandingkan the beginning. Dan yang the end, what is your conclusion or summary? Apa kesimpulannya? Yeah. This section should briefly recap what has been covered in the presentation and give the audience the final take-home messages. Think about the one thing you want someone to remember from your talk or poster. Jadi, ketika anda presentasi itu, berikan kesan yang baik. Yeah. Apa yang harus diingat oleh audience setelah anda presentasi? Tidak hanya selain tentang materi, tapi juga what is the most valuable thing that people can get from your presentation. So think about the one thing you want someone to remember from your talk or poster. Alternatively, it can be really effective to start at the end and think about the one point you want your audience to take away from your presentation. Then you can work backwards to decide what needs to go in other sections to build your arguments. Jadi, satu slide dengan slide berikutnya harus fokus satu-satu. Dan gunakan setiap slide itu sebagai wadah atau media komunikasi dengan audience. Ya. Itu yang harus dipertimbangkan. The next one we see, nah ini guiding your audience, ini cara kita membimbing audience. Audience siapa, kita lihat ya. Nah, language can be used to guide an audience, still dari Institute for Academic Development in the University of Edinburgh. It's going to be interesting. I would love to go to the UK one day. Language can be used to guide an audience or reader when presenting ideas, results, or an argument. The tone will differ depending on the assignment and discipline. For example, first person I think is not always appropriate. Okay, jadi I think, kata misalnya I think itu enggak bagus. So you need to change the other expression. Instead of saying I think, introduce an outline at the start. Outline the structure of the assignment or talk. Pertama, Anda susun dulu apa outline-nya ya. Kemudian introduce your work and make its purpose clear. Perkenalkan apa penelitian Anda dan pastikan tujuannya jelas. Jadi jangan don't beating around the bush. Jangan bertele-tele, langsung to the point. Nah, the purpose of my research is my work is about this. Ya. Yang ketiga, put key information on your title, slide, or page. Letakkan informasi di judul slide atau di halaman. For a talk, introduce yourself and colleagues and welcome your audience. Nah, jadi, perkenalkan diri Anda dan rekan-rekan Anda serta salam kepada pendengar saya. Seperti saya di awal tadi, welcome again students to our class, academic and professional speaking. Nah, ya. Itu caranya. So you interact with your audience. Karena audience Anda juga sama seperti Anda. Mereka juga manusia. Jadi namanya manusia tentu harus ada interaksi namanya. For a presentation, take care of management issues. There will be time at the end for questions. A copy of this paper will be available. You will find full references and contact details on handout or website. So these three are important. Ya. Jadi kita harus mengatur manajemen. Isu dari manajemen atau pengaturan ketika kita presentasi. Misalnya kita bilang, there will be time at the end for questions. Jadi akan ada pertanyaan di bagian akhir misalnya. Atau salinan paper ini will be available in the front door misalnya. Pintu depan misalnya di sebuah hall itu saya bisa presentasi. Di pintu hall itu sudah saya copy misalnya sekitar 15 atau 20 rangkap. Meskipun pendengarnya lebih dari itu. Nanti siapa yang duluan bisa mereka dapatkan salinan. Yeah, so it's not going to be that much. Bisa juga, you will find full references and contact details on handout. Jadi, di copy tadi itu, salinannya itu sudah dapat mereka lihat. Atau kita juga bisa gunakan ini, istilah ketika kita introduce an outline at the start, I'm going to examine the concept of, I'm going to explain the concept of, I'm going to explore the concept of, apa konsepnya? This presentation or essay will outline the benefits of apa manfaatnya. Kita sebutkan itu ya. Yang ketiga, I will suggest or propose or argue that this challenges the current practice of this challenges the prevailing belief of atau this challenges the theory of the practice of apa gitu. Nah, jadi ini pilihan artinya. This work aims to demonstrate that bla bla bla. Nah, jadi contoh misalnya this work aims to demonstrate that the use of gadget for English teaching and learning is important for the digital era these days depending on the circumstances locally. Contoh berikutnya, introduce your work seperti ini. In particular, I will discuss or consider, in particular, I will focus on, it is important to consider several aspects of, I will be looking at this from several perspectives, blah, blah, blah. This presentation will cover the following areas, first, blah, 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 second, blah, 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 third, blah, blah, blah. Jadi, Anda atur itu, berapanya. Kemudian, this talk will be divided into an section. Misalnya ada 2 atau 3 bagian yang akan Anda jelaskan. You can say, this talk will be divided into 3 sections. First, A section. Then, B section. And finally, C section. Jadi Anda atur. I will start by giving a brief description of apa? I will start by reviewing a brief description of, or I will start by introducing a brief description of, seperti itu. Jadi, Anda pilih mana yang cocok untuk presentasi Anda. Berikutnya kita lihat, link and signal as you move from one part to the next. Nah, jadi dari satu slide ke slide lainnya, harus Anda perhatikan apa yang menjadi unsur penting dari slide tersebut ya. Move from one part to the next. First, sum up or re-emphasize the main point or message. Sum up ini Anda berikan ringkasan apa poin pentingnya dari slide tersebut. Nah, kemudian one part to the next. Then give what is the main point. Then show how one section relates to another. Jadi tunjukkan bagaimana satu bagian dari presentasi kita akan berkaitan dengan presentasi berikutnya. So, one side to the other side is connected thoroughly. Contoh misalnya, having given you a brief outline of, I will now, having given you a brief outline of information from the book, I will now explain to you the theory from the University of Edinburgh. Itu contohnya. Jadi dikaitkan per poinnya, aspeknya. Ya. Dan contoh berikutnya, having considered bla bla bla, we can now look at atau we can now turn to. Contoh saya kasih. Having considered the use of internet, we now look at the use of internet in teaching and learning process. Or having considered the use of internet, we can now turn to the advantage of using internet for teaching and learning purposes. Third, having established or seen that, it follows that we should. Jadi kalimat ketiga ini misalnya, having established or having seen that internet helps many people for communication these days, it follows that we should be considerate in the use of internet. Seperti itu. Jadi, contohnya adalah beberapa poin-poin ini. So that's going to be very interesting if you pay attention to this one. The next, refer directly to visual material. Ini sama seperti poin sebelumnya, refer directly. Jadi, jangan biarkan slide Anda itu berbicara sendiri, Anda berbicara juga. Jadi, mana yang akan diperhatikan oleh audience? So, when you say about something, always relate that to your visual material. Choose the right point to focus your audience or reader's attention. Nah, seperti saya berikan kursor ini ya. Kursor ini saya tunjukkan mouse ini yang sedang saya baca ya. This is going to be very interesting. And we see the first one is, as you can see from this chart or table or map, we can see that blah blah blah. As this result shows, nah, misalnya figure 4, misalnya di PowerPoint slide Anda ini, Anda menampilkan tabel. Anda tuju tabelnya itu. Nah, lingkar seperti ini. Ya. If you look at this, misalnya, contoh saya tunjuk ini. If you look at this writing, we can see that the font of this letter is interesting. Itu contohnya. Ya. Nah, jadi, ada beberapa poin yang bisa kita lakukan ketika memberikan penjelasan. Nah, ini sebelumnya ya. Ada beberapa introduce and outline at the start, then link and signal as you move from one part to the next. Refer directly to visual material and conclude. Don't just stop. Nah, jangan lupa ini, berikan kesimpulan. Jangan tiba-tiba saya berhenti. Give your time a certain amount of time to make yourself able to conclude. Sum up briefly and clearly to make sure the logic of your argument is emphasized. Jadi pastikan logika dari pendapat Anda emphasized, jadi ada penekanan. Dan yang ketiga, emphasize the main point or message to take away. Nah, jadi ada penekanan ya bahwa apa pesan yang harus dibawa oleh audience. Contoh, so to sum up, I will say that blah blah blah. Tau, if we recap the main points or argument, first, second, and third, it should be clear that blah 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 blah. Apa contoh lainnya? Having done this research, having done data analysis, data procedure, and data description, I would like to finish by giving information about data reduction. So yeah. In conclusion, I would like to emphasize or stress that blah blah blah. Jadi ini ekspresi yang bisa kalian gunakan ketika Anda membimbing audience. Jadi audience Anda menarik atau tertarik dalam mendengarkan penjelasan Anda. It's going to be so interesting for your audience to follow your description from the beginning to the end. So don't forget one thing. In a talk, invite questions if appropriate. Thank you, your audience is appropriate. Nah, jadi jangan lupakan, I welcome questions to my students. If you have any question, please write down your question below. Keaktifan kalian di dalam keaktifan kalian di dalam memberikan ini penjelasan is going to be very important yeah, for people to really understand about this one. The next one is oral presentation. Practice, practice, practice. Ini menarik ya. Giving a talk can be daunting. If you have a spoken presentation to give, with or without slides, make sure you have time to rehearse it several times. Jadi pastikan kita bisa mendengarnya beberapa waktu. Yeah. Rehearse it. Tampil dulu seolah kita menjelaskan materinya. So for several times. Firstly, this is really good at helping you overcome any nerves as you know exactly what you're going to say. It will build your confidence. Jadi, berbeda kalau di Zoom. Kalau di Zoom kan saya bisa gampang nih ya. Baca teksnya, lalu saya jelaskan, saya melihat kepada kamera. I'm talking as if I'm imagining that you are listening to me right now. Tapi kalau misalnya ketika kalian berbicara di depan hall, in front of the audience, then, excuse me, you need to pay attention to this. You need to build your confidence. Saying something aloud is a really effective way to check for sense, structure, and flow. If it is difficult to say or doesn't sound right, then the audience may find it difficult to follow what you are trying to say. Jadi, mengatakan sesuatu itu dengan suara yang lantang, dengan suara keras itu sangat bagus untuk beberapa titik-titik penting di dalam presentasi kita. Therefore, seperti itu, we need to do the research carefully. Nah, jadi ada kata carefully, itu berarti penekanan. Finally, practicing helps you know how long your presentation will take. If your presentation is being assessed, you may be penalized for going over time as that would be unfair to other presenters. It is like going over your word count. Jadi, perhatikan penggunaan waktu. Kalau Anda diberikan waktu 10 menit untuk presentasi, udah, cukup 10 menit. Makanya, menit pertama itu Anda sudah mulai presentasi. Jadi, jangan fokus tetek bengek, misalnya laptop, kemudian infocus atau projector, semuanya disetting, habis waktu 5 menit. Sebelum itu sudah disetel semuanya, ya. That's one thing that you need to remember. If you can, find out what resources and equipment you will have when you present. It is usually expected that presenters will wear or use a microphone so that everyone can hear. Also, think about how you are going to use your visual material. Nah, perhatikan apa alat-alat yang akan kita gunakan di saat presentasi. Jangan sampai tertinggal. Ya. Pastikan semuanya you are ready. Apalagi ketika nanti Anda akan kompre. Anda akan menjelaskan materinya kepada dosen, kepada penguji, kepada pembimbing, kepada teman-teman yang satu angkatan. So, you need to practice. Okay, now, alright. That would be it for my explanation in this part one. Untuk meeting ke-6, I'm going to be talking about part two, how to be a good speaker on academic presentation. Jadi bagaimana menjadi pembicara akademik di academic presentation, konteks presentasi akademik. Alright, thank you for listening to my explanation. The point is that a good speaker is a well-prepared speaker. And in the context of academic presentation, the speaker has the mastery of what he or she is going to be talking about in the presentation, and the presentation itself is organized carefully. That's the point of part one in this video. I'm going to meet again with you for part two, so stay tuned. Until then, have a good day for all of you. It's already 50 minutes. Thank you for listening to me. I stop here. All right. So have a good day for all of you. So, semoga sehat selalu dan jangan lupa jaga kesehatan. Ikuti janjian dari pemerintah and be a good citizen. Selalu jaga kedamaian sama kita. Ya. Have a good day. Sampai jumpa. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.